I was striker until my 23s actually. I went to see some players in the stadium, and now I'm the player on the pitch. So after the Euro, I signed for Watford.
Christian, massive thank you for taking the time to join me today. I'm really excited to have you on here. If you can, take things back all the way before football even came a thing for you. What was the first ever match or you either went to or saw on TV? Can you remember that?
Yes, I remember my first game was actually I didn't know at that time that I would play for them, but it was at Genk in Belgium. So I was maybe 10 years old, something like this. And it was a Champions League game against Real Madrid. So this was my first experience in a football stadium. And yeah, the story tells me after that I played for the team that I saw first in life. So yeah, it's a nice story.
Nice. And what a game to go to as well. Not only obviously the team that's playing against, but also Champions League as well. That must have been crazy, like the atmosphere for it as well.
Yeah, it was incredible. I remember, thanks to my friend, we had some tickets in the Real Madrid away fans. So yeah, it was a typical Spanish atmosphere. And the Real Madrid at that time, it was likes of Luis Figo, Roberto Carlos, this amazing team. So yeah, it was not bad game to start with.
Nice, fantastic. Now it's interesting because the reason why I always like to go back to this is because, you know, as a young kid growing up, and if we enjoy football, and especially obviously if you go to games or watch it on TV, you obviously have an interest. But I always think that, you know, players are obviously motivated to want to become a footballer. But when you go to a game or see a game on TV, I think it just kind of sparks the interest even more because, you know, seeing the atmosphere, seeing some of the players that, like, you know, you idolise growing up, and it just creates a whole new sort of atmosphere. And I don't know if you're the same, but one of the things I've always noticed is that whenever I go to games and I watch professionals play, there's one thing that always stands out, and that's their touch. Their touch of the ball, wherever you play the ball, whether it's in the air, whether it's along the ground, whether there's players around them, whether they're by themselves, the touches are absolutely immaculate. And it's crazy to see that, you know, such a small, minute detail, but yet such an important one, is such a key thing. Did you notice anything like that within the game, or was there any other standout point you saw from actually watching the match?
Yes, you said it. The touch of the ball, it's totally different than on TV. And yeah, the you can see when you are at the stadium, every player talking. When you see on TV, they are only focused on the ball. But when you go to the stadium, you can see what the goalkeeper is doing when the ball is in play. So it gives me as well this feeling that one time I want to be there and I want to do the same thing. I remember when I saw a player coming to the touchline to get some words from the manager, I was like, "Hey, look, the manager is talking to him." So yeah, when you are young, you are more focused on these details. But obviously, when you grow up, you start to see and to think about, yeah, the defensive line is doing this when the ball is up, and all these kind of little details that you notice when you are in a football world.
Yeah, no, do you know, that's a fantastic point. I was about to pick up on that about the, you know, typically when we think of defenders, and I've talked to a few defenders now, and we always say that, because I was a centre-back myself, and let's be honest, centre-backs and defenders isn't the most glamorous of positions, because as you said, people purely focus on the goals, and even if the defenders are involved, they're more so focusing on the attackers and what the attackers are doing. But I think it's so interesting because the point you picked up on there is, you know, obviously defending happens when obviously the opposite team are on the attack. So that's one phase of seeing the defending element of it. But like you said, seeing kind of, or being able to see, because we don't see that on TV as much, what happens when your team's in possession and, like, say, for example, the attackers or the wingers have got the ball, what are the defenders doing then, you know? How are they communicating with each other? That's one of the key things I learned about just how important communication is between the defence when off the ball, really, and, you know, your rest of your teammates have got it. And like you said, I think that's such a key point about being able to almost pick up on those things as the game's happening?
Yes, of course, because you know, when you play against a team and maybe there is a scout of the next opponent in the stand, it will be focused on what the defenders are doing when they're attacking. Does they do offensive marking? Does they reduce the space between the lines? So there is so much information to take, and defending is not only about the 1v1 situation when the striker is coming to you. It's a 95 minutes work, so you need to be focused every time. And the most of the defender, they don't get the lights that they deserve, because it's really, really difficult. It's a full-time job, you know, when you are a defender, you do one mistake. You can be good for 90 minutes, but you do one mistake. At the end of the day, we will speak about your mistake even at the 90th minute. But if you are a striker, you can miss 5 chances and score the last minute winner, and you say, yeah, he did a top game. So this is the difficult part of the defender. And you need to be really strong in the head to play in this position.
Yeah, no, 100%. Like you said, I think a lot of it is mentally, and, you know, probably about 5% is the actual technical elements of, you know, what you actually do when the ball's around you, kind of thing. So, yeah, no, really important point. So how did the journey kind of start for you? So obviously, like you said, that was kind of your first experience of actually going to a live game and probably getting a little bit of motivation and aspirations from, you know, wow, I could do this, and this is where, you know, I kind of want to take my pathway within football. But how did the kind of journey start for you? And also, as we kind of just said, you know, typically people think of defence as not the most glamorous positions, although I loved being a defender when I was younger. I don't know whether or not it was the element of seeing people being able to slide and being able to slide in on people and things like that. But yeah, how did defence come about for you? Because over in England, it's sort of phasing out now, but typically, so I'm quite tall, and I don't think I even really had a choice. I think someone just said to me, look, you're tall, you're big, you go as defence. And that was kind of how a lot of academies picked centre-backs up or defenders up. There's like, you're big physically, so we can work on the technical things around you. How did it kind of develop for yourself?
But for me, it started as a striker, first of all. Well, I was striker until my 23s, actually. So I did a very late change of position. So as you said, nobody wants to be defender in the beginning. Wants to be me. I wanted to be like Thierry Henry because I was a big fan of Arsenal. But you want to be like Ronaldo. You want to be like Messi. You don't want to be like Rio Ferdinand. You don't want to be like Nemanja Vidic, for example, or Sergio Ramos. You just want to score goals and be part of the attack and just playing with the ball. So I was a striker. I wanted to be a striker. And at some point of my career, when I was in open, we were missing one defender, and the championship start the week after. And the manager one day to me and said, listen, we don't have time to buy something or someone. So I will try to put you in defense because, as you said, you are tall, you are fast, you are good in the air. So I will see. And I started to play like 30 minutes in a friendly game. And after, he put me for the first game of the season, and we won 4-0 that game. And that's how my journey as a defender starts at the age of 22 years old. And 7 years, 7 years later, I played more than 100 games for an English team. So it's quite amazing.
Yeah, no, it's quality. And do you know what? When you were saying that, it brought me back to some flashbacks of when I was playing. And I remember one time there wasn't a goalkeeper. And, you know, I thought, I'm quite a polite person. And I was like, yeah, do you know what? Like, I'll go in goal. It's fine. They're not here this week, but, you know, they'll be back next week. Somehow, don't ask me how, I managed to keep a clean sheet. That was the worst mistake of my life, because ultimately I was then kept in goal for a while, and for whatever reason, the goalkeeper came back and they continued to play him out on field. And I was like, hold on, he's back. Why have I got continuing goal? But I think, you know, you just kind of, at the end of the day, you play football, don't you? So it's wherever you play on the field, you know, you're getting the chance to play the game, really. But did you find that it was a bit of a benefit? Because when I've spoken to players in the past and they've mentioned about positions that they play, they typically analyze the opposing position to them. To say, for example, if you're like a left winger, they might focus on the right back, because if they can analyze the right back's game, they can kind of get a bit of a mental or psychological advantage, because they might know when they're going to press, or they might know where they're going to move, or, you know, typically if they're in possession, how high up the field they may go. Did you kind of feel that from being a striker, you almost knew a few of the tricks of the trades of what a forward or a striker might do?
Yes, especially in my early years, during my change, I had the feeling that every time that I anticipate something, I always get the ball. And because at that time, I didn't have any kind of formation as a defender. So I was trying to play like sometimes, I will not say by closing my eyes, but I wanted to guess where the ball will be and what the striker will do. So in the beginning, I was... My game was most of the time about anticipation. After with the years and with the experience that I get, I behave more like a defender. But yeah, at that time I was just a striker who tried to defend and defend quite well at that moment. So yeah, it's sometimes funny how things can change because I never expected that 22 years old changed my position. Never.
No, that's cool. It goes to show the sort of character you are, that, you know, there's some characters who would say typically, look, no, do you know what? I'm a striker. Don't want to change. But, you know, if you're a confident player and also kind of goes back down to the team element of things, do you know what? Ultimately, you're playing football still. And yeah, look how effective you've been within defence. And, you know, I mean, not to say that if you stayed a striker, you know, you could have had many goals across the season. But it's nice to see that you've transitioned and you've still been ultra effective in that position as well.
Yeah, to be honest, I didn't really have the many choice, because it was my last year of contract at that club. So it was either I'm stay focused on my striker position, and the manager was clear with me, I will be on the bench, I will not be the one of the starter, and if I became a defender, I will have more chance to play. So I was thinking, yeah, it's my last year of contract. Does I want to gamble and maybe in one season we'll be without contract, or maybe try to go and play as a defender? So I choose to be fit defender, and it was probably the best choice of my career.
Yeah, nice, Colin. And it's like you said, it's funny how things turn out, and you know that sometimes, not a negative, but you know, we can sometimes turn situations which we're uncertain about, but actually turn them into positives. And like you said, look what you've gone on to try and, or look what you've gone on to go and do. So just talk me through that sort of journey as sort of like the first team that you kind of ever joined as a child, and then taking it through to sort of that debut game. Because obviously, like you mentioned before, you went to go and see a game at Genk, and, you know, you kind of got a bit of a feel of the atmosphere of, you know, what it's like on a match day potentially. But how did that sort of transpire into when you officially made your debut as a pro?
Yeah, it was when I was 17. So it was in a pen. I joined this team when I was 14 years old. So it was a team second league in Belgium at that time. Before that, I was in a village, like a small club near for my home, just to enjoy with my friends. And the funny thing is that when I decided to move to a pen, it was 35 minutes from home, and I wanted to be with my friends as well. So I asked the club to pick up two of my friends to come with me, and they agree with that. So I was able to stay with my friends, because I was for me the friends relationship was really important even at that time. And yeah, so I went there. I played first with the under 15, after under 16, and arrived the moment when I was wanted by another club, by Standard de Liège in first division in Belgium. So at that moment, Eupen decided to put me in the first team when I was supposed to play with under 17. So I was 16 years old when I joined the first team, and I had to wait a couple of months to play my first game at the age of 17 years old, 20 minutes of my my debut, and yeah, I was thinking about the game that I watched in Genk. I was saying yes. I went to see some players in the stadium, and now I'm the player on the pitch. So yeah, the kid that I was at that time was more than happy.
That's quality, and it's so nice to see that. You know, we typically think, obviously, a lot of players that come through, you know, you would have had to have gone through a similar process of, you know, probably playing from a young age at a local team, and then obviously going through academies, and then obviously first team, and obviously at some point going to see a game, whether it's live or on TV. But yeah, I can imagine when it actually comes to fruition and it actually happens, you know, I was going to say it's almost a bit of a pinchy moment, but I suppose there's just so much going on, obviously, you know, game mode, opposition, teammates, manages tactics, fans, you know, you probably even don't get a second to think about, wow, what am I doing here, but, you know, wow, what's going on around me sort of thing. I suppose it's just straight up game mode, is it?
Yeah, it's really that, because, you know, you are playing with people that maybe they have 30 years old and they have a lot of experience, and you go there and you don't have time to think about what to do. You just want to enjoy and try to show that that maybe I had the possibility to play a part in the team. So I remember the night before I didn't sleep because I was too exciting to be part of the squad, and yeah, when you go on the pitch, you just want to, every time the ball, you, I wasn't scared. I just wanted to enjoy and to I took it like a reward as well for my father, because my father was working during the night, and most of the time when I was young we were playing on the mornings, and there was some weekends he didn't sleep at night even in the morning he didn't sleep at all to drop me at the football club. So it was a reward as well for my father, for all the sacrifice that he did for me.
Yeah, do you know what? That point you make there, it's often something which always happens, but no one really sees it as part of the journey. But how much commitment, time, effort, you know, input that parents have. Because, yeah, like, you know, one of the big things is, especially over here in, like, so I live in London, and one of the big things I always talk about typically with players from London is that the issue you have is that a lot of the time parents may not even have transport. So a lot of players miss out on opportunities because, you know, they can't get to training or they have to go by themselves. And, you know, typically sometimes it might not be safe, especially if they're coming back late at night, or, you know, they have to take multiple ways of transport. So, yeah, I think, do you know what, parents and peers as well, because I think, like you said as well, about having two of your friends come along with you, having peers, family, you know, they really do help support that journey. And, you know, it's not necessarily sort of like undermined, but it's something which obviously only yourself, the player, will know just how much of an impact that's obviously had on your journey and getting you to the stage where you are almost.
Yeah, it's really important to have this environment around you, because, you know, if you don't have the good people around you, maybe instead of telling you to go to the training, they will say, let's go, we go to the city, we go some shopping, or we go in the nightclub or whatever. So it's a lot of sacrifice. Me, when I was young, I almost never went out to do party in the night or to go with my friends in the city, because I had training, and you need to do this kind of sacrifice. If you want to be a football player, it's not all about, yeah, now he's football player, he's earning good money, he's playing in a top club, he's living in a good hotel or whatever. There is a lot of sacrifice before that, and it's not easy at all to become a football player. If it was easy, everybody would be a football player, but you need a lot of sacrifice and a lot of commitment to be a football player.
Yeah, no, totally. And, you know, like you mentioned there, I think, again, those sacrifices are part of that journey. And, you know, it's almost like the barriers which help you overcome that. But, you know, obviously credit to yourself that, you know, like having those sacrifices along the journey, look at what it's gone on to allow you to achieve and where you are now. And obviously since that day in game, and like you said, since some of those sacrifices which you've had to take, you know, like you said, you played over 100 games for Watford. You know, you played in the Belgian League, you played internationally as well. What is that sort of process like in terms of going through these different stages? So academies, first teams, international stage. What's the sort of like number one coaching that you receive at those different stages? And also, what were some of the barriers or challenges? I know you mentioned sacrifices, but in getting to these different points throughout your career?
First of all, the first coaching that I received, it's about work. Work every day and repeat every day what you will maybe face during the game. I wasn't maybe one of the top talent in my team. That there were some player more talented than me, but without the work and without the anger, I would say, to be angry, to be better than the other players, you it's impossible to be a football player. You know, there was a lot of top talent in Europe, and most of them, they don't reach maybe the level of Kylian Mbappe or Erling Haaland because they are not serious enough in their work, and they just don't work day by day. And being a football player is a work day by day. Even now I'm at home, I'm not at the training grounds, but I'm still working because I don't eat like sweets, chocolates. I try to sleep at a good time. So it's all about work. And all the coach that I had, they have the first word that they had in their mouth. It's all about working. So yeah, it's a really tough mentally, because day by day you need to have the strength to do the same thing and to get the reward after during the game, because you need to suffer during the week to have maybe more easier during the games. So yeah, that's the world. If I will be a coach as well, I will maybe exaggerate on the word work.
Yeah, nice. And I think like you mentioned there, you know, obviously you'll go through your different like stages of your career. Obviously, we know how ruthless and reckless football can be in terms of managers being with you one moment and then gone the next moment. So in being able to sort of extract all the bits from players, yeah, exactly. But yeah, being able to sort of extract all those bits from each of the coaches, I think helps, because you know, obviously at some point, someone's going to have had to say to you, like, you know, listen, you need to put in work. And that's kind of stuck with you in your mind. And then, you know, another coach might come in and say like not a different thing, like opposing to work, but, you know, they might say, for example, like you said before, sleep well, eat well. And, you know, all these bits you can take. And I almost think it's like building a character, really, because in a way, from a selfish perspective, you know, you're going to be the ultimate version of all of the coaches that you've had, because you've been able to extract all the bits. Whereas one individual obviously has their traits, characteristics, knowledge, skills, but you can take almost what you want from each one along your journey.
Yeah, that's true. It's like a jigsaw. Every time that you have a new manager, there is always something new that you maybe the previous manager didn't know. So that's why I'm always saying, even if I'm 30 years old now, I still have a lot to improve, because maybe in 2 seasons I will find a manager who will teach me new things. So yeah, it's you have to be open and wants to learn every time, learn every day, work every day, because now I see a lot of young players, they are just focused on the numbers of followers on Instagram, maybe to show the good life, but this is not being a football player. This is just want to live like a football player. But being a football player, it's a 200% commitment to your work, and you don't get anything without sacrifice. And in terms of sacrifice, as I said, it's maybe if you have one friend who call you to go out, you have to say no because I have game tomorrow or I have training and this kind of thing. So yeah, it's not easy, but the reward at the end of the career, it's unbelievable.
100%, and it goes back to that work ethic again, because like you said, you know, while somebody's focusing on, you know, gaining and attracting followers to their social media accounts, and somebody else is working and, you know, putting in that effort and that commitment and that growth within themselves and as a player, yeah, you know, you're gonna be able to see that only on one place, and that's going to be on the football pitch. So that's quite an interesting way of analysing it. Do you think it's been harder to sort of become the player or maintain being the player? Because, you know, sometimes I've spoken to players and they've said, you know what, the easy part was getting a trial, although that never reflected well on my career. I didn't get too many trials. But, you know, some people say it's easier to get a trial. And then, you know, once you're in the door, then it's harder about maintaining. Whereas other people have been like, you know, it was really hard getting to that stage, and it's been a bit easier sort of going through the process. What did you find through your experiences?
Now, for me, the most difficult is to maintain and to stay at the level where you are, because as I said before, it's a daily basis sacrifice that you have to do. It's maybe sometimes it will be quite boring to do the same things, you know, to have the same routine, like doing the gym work after training, even if you're tired, maybe on your day off, wake up to do some gym work as well at home or some running. So this is the most difficult part. Of course, it's difficult to reach a certain level and to get a chance to show your qualities. But if you, I will take an example. If you start to play in the starting 11, and because you are in the starting 11, you stop working, at some point, you will be out of the starting 11. But you think that, yeah, I'm playing good, the manager loves me, the fans loves me. So maybe you will think, yeah, I'm there, so I will try to slow down and I will work less. But for me, it's that is in that moment that you have to work more to stay in your starting 11, because behind you there is a player who wants your position, and after you want to compete as long as possible at the best level. And for this, you need to work, even if everything is going in the right direction for you. And yeah, for me, this is the most hard work in the head to do with yourself. It's almost a fight with yourself to keep doing the same thing day by day, no matter if you are in the starting 11 or not.
Yeah, exactly. And also, as well, like we said, obviously, you know, throughout your career, especially at Watford, there's been quite a few changes of managers. And I suppose it's almost like, you know, even like you said, if you are playing well, you're almost having to retrial yourself each time a new manager comes in, because say, for example, if they have a different way of playing, or, you know, typically, let's be honest, if a manager gets sacked or loses their job, you know, typically it's because they've been losing games or the form hasn't been as great. And, you know, again, like we said, the unfortunate sort of burden that gets put on our head as defenders is, you know, well, let's look at the defensive side of things, because ultimately, if we've been leaking in goals, that must be where the issue is. So almost, yeah, I suppose it's like you said, the work has to continue, and it's harder maintaining it, because it is every time you're out there, you're almost proving your worth as to why you should be in the starting 11 and why you should almost be under the new manager's plans.
Yeah, that's right. Because you will never find a manager who will start with a new manager who will start with the same starting 11 as the previous one. So if you already had the routine of working and do everything that you can, even if you are in the starting 11, after you will not have to change your routine and try to face a new situation, because you will be used to work to work, even if you are playing. So yeah, when a new manager is coming in a new team, he always try to find what was wrong. Sometimes it's the defense, sometimes it's the goal scoring, and yeah, even if you start all the game and you were doing good, when a new manager come, he always wants to put like his touch to maybe take out of the fridge some player that were not playing a lot to give them the chance. So yeah, it's not easy every time to change like this manager. So as well, again, I will say, if you until you are you are honest with yourself and you have the good work ethic, I think you will have less problem by changing your manager several times.
100%, 100%. And it goes back to that mental side of things, of being mentally strong enough to keep on almost resetting each time. So, you know, it's quality. So, like I said, you've obviously started to delve into the sort of coaching world and obviously getting your qualifications. Number one, how are you finding that? And number two, do you almost wish you'd done it earlier? Because when I've spoken to players about going into the coaching industry, they said that, like, number one, they didn't realize how much, you know, thought processes go into the coaching. And number two, how much it's benefited them from being able to see things from a different aspect, almost from just being a player.
Yeah, me, I love the courses that we are doing, because as you said, I'm watching the game in a different way now. I try to watch the game with what I've learned before with my lessons. So yeah, for the moment I'm enjoying this. I don't know if I will be a coach after, but to answer to your second question, I think it's the right moment to do it. Earlier, I didn't have the thoughts of being a manager, but with the national team, they propose us to do it in a fastest way. So instead of having the UEFA A and B in 2 years, we can do it in 1 year. Nice. So I took the chance and the possibility to have it in 1 year, because of course, I hope that I will finish my career as late as possible. But at least at the end of my career, this is something that I have in my hands. I will not have to do this process again to study this thing again. I'm fully playing football, so it's easier for me to try to learn new things about the badges.
Nice. No, I think it's exciting. I think, you know, when you said about you doing the coaching badges, you know, it brings a good feeling, because, you know, ultimately sometimes people have issues in the coaching industry or players going into coaching. But from my perspective, there's two ways to look at it. Number one, that you have the technical understanding of obviously being a player. You obviously have the experience as well. And I think a responsibility of a coach anyway is, without sort of directly doing it, when you're coaching players, you're almost coaching the next crop of coaches, because, you know, if coaches can give you the understanding, the knowledge, the not just the how, but the when, where's and why's, then ultimately, again, like I mentioned earlier on, you're kind of extracting all these things from all these coaches, and it just creates a better coach, really, because, you know, you're a player and then you become a coach, or like I said, even if you don't, you have all that understanding as to not only the hows, but the when's, the where's, the why's, and just a lot more understanding of the game, really, whereas opposed to before. Sometimes I suppose it gets a little bit easier to see it from just a player's point of view and maybe even just your position. Whereas, you know, I mean, the fortunate thing is you played as a striker, but when you see things from other positions and, you know, how your movement can affect, say, for example, the winger who is well away from you, but it's that whole off the ball sort of situational stuff. So, yeah, no, I think it's exciting. And, yeah, don't stop playing yet. Keep going for as long as you can. But it's exciting to see if you do make that transition to coaching, or even just that, you know, thought process of what the coaching industry is like.
Yeah, last I think it was 2 or 3 months ago, I had the chance to give my first session as a coach to the young, I think it was the under 20, under 18 in Watford. So yeah, you can see that as well. Is a totally different things of being player and being coach, because there is a, and especially being coach with the young players, because you know with the first team you have a lot of interns or are preparing everything for the pitch or all the drills. But I found out that when you are coaching with the young kids, you have to do it. You have to do it by yourself. So it's kind of discovering something new. Try to test yourself, and yeah, hopefully I hope at the end of the year I will be able to get my badges.
No, that's quality, and it's interesting because, you know, every time as well, we always think coaching, you know, we just think of the football side of things, but sometimes it's just managing that group. Sometimes it's managing individuals. And like you said, even just the putting out the codes and stuff like that, it's such an underestimated world, because I think, you know, even myself, when I went into coaching originally, I never knew 13 years on just how much stuff. And listen, from my point of view, I'm still at the start of my journey, even 13 years on, and it's incredible just how much detail and thought and aspects of football go into coaching, and not even just football, just life. Like I said, dealing with different characters, dealing with different personalities, managing the group and gaining respect almost as well. Because, you know, I coach sometimes 8-10-year-olds, and do you know what? I'm happy to admit it, they know more than me, because they've had hundreds of coaches come into their life and, you know, drip feed them with all these different parts of information. And I've got to make sure that when I go into them, even though they might be 8 or 10 years old, that I'm telling them the right things, because otherwise I'll soon get caught out along that journey. And we almost don't realize that almost.
Yeah, that's totally true. I remember when I gave the session, one kid came to me for one drill, and he said, can I do this instead of what I was asking him to do? And what he was saying was perfectly true. It was not the same of what I was saying, but it was good as well. So yeah, you can learn and you can exchange this as well as when you are a coach, you can get this experience from the player, even if they are only 16 or 17 years old.
Yeah, 100%. It's definitely interesting. But no, listen, you've had a fantastic career so far, and you know, you've still got plenty more years left in you. I'd just like to try and pick up on some fun questions and some fun points of what you've experienced throughout your career. So obviously, centre-back, obviously, like you said before, I didn't know it was only such a short period of time, but you know, being a centre-back, is there any sort of centre-backs which have retired throughout the game which you kind of look back on and think, do you know what? I would have loved to have played with that player, having them alongside me.
Yes, I would say Rio Ferdinand, because he had everything for that a top centre back have to have. He won trophies. He was good in the air. He was good on the ball. So yeah, it was so dominant and so charismatic. And I would love to play with him.
Fantastic. Good as well. You mentioned some of those key points there of, you know, it wasn't just the technical side of things, it was also the, you know, like you said, the build up of the character almost as well, which is nice to hear. But yeah, no, good choice. And definitely a centre back, which I think I would have loved to have played against. I wouldn't have probably had to do that much. I think he would have dealt with most of it himself, but that's quality. And then as well, I always think to myself, and I'll take this back to when I was in school, there was always one kid that was good at everything. Like, it didn't matter what sport it was, whether it was football, basketball, tennis, table tennis, trampolining, anything it could have been. There was just this one kid that was always very good at everything, which I found throughout class. Was there any other sports which you thought to yourself, do you know what? I'm pretty good at this, and do you know what? I could potentially go quite far in this, or was it just purely football?
I wasn't that kid. It wasn't. No, me, it was only football. I tried once to do judo.
Okay.
Some judo, but after the first session, I went to my mother and I asked her, why should I hurt somebody who didn't do anything to me? So, yeah, I was maybe too pacific for doing judo. So, no, me, it was only football. And it's funny because I can see right now with my son as well. He's five, and we bought him like some basketball, some tennis racket, and he always finished with the football. So yeah, it's football, football as well for him every time. So only football at home.
Fantastic. It's funny as well because, do you know what, like a lot of children are like that, and I think, you know, you can give them different things and say, look, try this out, try that one out, try it out for a couple of seconds or a minute, tries that one out for a couple of seconds or a minute, like you said, always goes back to the football. So that's quality. And then again, you know, you've had such an illustrious career so far, obviously played in multiple teams across Europe, obviously played internationally as well, and it's a bit cliche, but not only looking at the technical aspects, but also maybe the social, so who you got on well with, and also the psychological, so, you know, which plays a really great decision making. But if you had to pick, say, for example, in training, I know typically a lot of teams do five-a-side matches, who would you pick within your five-a-side team out of all the players that you played with throughout your career?
I think it will be almost a full Belgium player, full Belgium team, because, I had the chance to be in the national team with the Golden Generation in Belgium. So in goal, it would be Thibaut Courtois.
Nice.
He was incredible when he started, and during this time at Chelsea as well in Atletico, he won almost all the trophies possible. I will pick Vincent Kompany, the leader, the one of the best defender in the Premier League, and yeah, it's top defender. After, I will pick Eden Hazard because he's simply a genius. Next to him, Kevin De Bruyne, as well, like Hazard, what he's doing and the things that he can see during the game, it's unbelievable. And as a striker, I will pick Romelu Lukaku because I think he was really, really underestimated in England. And I never understand that because he was so powerful. He's quick in front of the goal. He's a killer, and he's proved now at Inter that he's one of the best strikers. Probably top five striker in Europe right now. So yeah, I think it's not about five-a-side.
Yeah, 100%. Not being funny, but I don't think I could pick many players to go up against that five-a-side and they'd look forward to it. So that's a quality team. But like I said, I think, you know, and including yourself in this as well, just the way in which the Belgium Football Association has been able to build what they have, you know, so many countries, let's say, envious of it. I mean, obviously, each country has their own identity in terms of, you know, their football philosophies and ways in which they want to develop their playing and their coaching side of things. But what an incredible, you know, plan. And it's not even just a plan, because it's been deliverable over so many years that Belgium has as a structure. And it's interesting because I've got a friend who is now working over in Belgium for a British school. And even there, they can see the impact in which football has had throughout the whole country. And, you know, we're still seeing it coming through now. The amount of young Belgian players which are coming through is honestly, it's scary. It is honestly scary to see how much of an impact is being made.
Yeah, the change a lot, the mentality, because before the Golden Generation, it was like, yeah, we were like 60, 70 in FIFA ranking. And as soon as all these players arrived in the national team and start to play together, even the mentality in the federation changed, and they realized that the formation, it's really, really important. And we will benefit as well of this player for many years, because now Vincent Kompany is a coach in Anderlecht. I'm doing my coaches badges with a lot of them, and maybe in 5-10 years there will be the people who will lead the federation and will be the best coach in Belgium. So So I think we have a good future in front of us.
Yeah, no, 100%. And that'd be brilliant to see people like yourselves or Vincent, like you said, at the top of the federation, or seeing your team go up against Vincent's team. I think that'd be a nice challenge as well. Yeah. But no, that's quality. But no, two final things I just wanted to pick up on. So number one, so far out of your career, has there been a sort of standout moment in terms of you've looked back and gone, do you know what? Like, I'm so proud of myself in achieving that. And what would you like your legacy to be within the game if you could leave a footprint within, whether it be in England, in Belgium, or just across the whole of the football community?
The best moment of my career so far was the Euro 2016. Yes, 2016 with Belgium. So before that, I never get a call for the national team. And there were a lot of injuries. And finally, I made the final squad to go in the Euro 2016. And it was unbelievable because I changed position only 3 seasons before that one. And being able to be in the national team in so quickly, it was incredible. And yes, the stadium was full. We played against a top player. So for me, I think it was as well the beginning of something for me, because after the Euro, I signed for Watford, and now I played more than 100 games for them. So yeah, it was really the best moment of my career. After about the blueprint that I want to left for the legacy is, yeah, in football, you know, we only remember the people who won something. So why not win something with Belgium? Why not win something with Watford or with one of my team? I think this is the challenge now. I'm starting to move towards the end of my career. So yeah, I want why not to win one of the top five league in Europe. I know that maybe people will laugh when they will hear that, but I think that everything is possible. You just need to believe in yourself, and I believe that by working hard, I will be able maybe with Belgium or with another team, or even with Watford. You know, when we were close to win the FA Cup with Watford 2 seasons ago, so I want to win a big trophy in Europe.
Nice. Now, listen, I think if anybody can do it, you can do it. Like I said, your career so far and what you've achieved, like you said, the work, just putting in the work, and I think it's played sort of fruition in terms of how your career has gone. And, you know, yeah, I think it'd be, like I said, it'd be a nice legacy to leave. But regardless, even if that doesn't happen, then I think honestly and truthfully, this is why it was such an honour and I'm so humbled to be able to have you on here. Like I said, for me, you've already made your impact within the game, and especially over here in England as well. I think, you know, there's a lot of young kids coming through and, you know, they should look at, number one, how you are as a player, then also number two, who you are really. I was going to say how you are as a personality, but yeah, who you are as an individual and what makes you up, because I think you're a big inspiration to a lot of young players and now coaches coming through the industry as well.
Yeah, people need to be careful, especially the player, because with me, it will be work every time.
Nice quality. But now listen, Christian, like I said, absolute honour to be able to have you on here, share your journey, get to know you better, and to see kind of where your career has gone and where it's going to as well. So all I can say is a massive thank you for taking the time to join me. It's been an absolute pleasure.
You're welcome. Thank you. I appreciate it. Nice conversation.